Our first set of selfish genetic elements were trying to distort the sex ratio in one way or the other. And in the meiotic drive of the mosquito, it was to produce just sons. In the case of the ladybirds, it was to produce just daughters. Now I want to get to a more widespread form of genetic element that is very, very selfish. And these are called transposons. These are also known as jumping genes that spread themselves throughout the genome. Now, these were discovered by a very famous Nobel Prize-winning geneticist, Barbara McClintock, back in the 1950s and 60s. And she discovered these through her studies of Indian corn. Now, the characteristic feature of Indian corn is the different kernels are different colors. And that's because each kernel of corn has a different genotype reflecting that of the fertilized seed. And in some of these, you've got pigments that are operating to produce these darker colors, and others that pigment's been turned off. Well, as it turns out, we're going to see, and this is a fairly confusing diagram, but bear with me, that we have a stretch of DNA here along a chromosome, and there is one gene down here colored in yellow. This is the confusing part. The normal yellow gene here produces a purple pigment. So if this is functioning properly, indicated by yellow, you get a purple pigment, okay? Now, further along on the DNA, there is a separate gene that is a transposon. And under certain circumstances, it's activated by yet another gene, so that now this DS gene, locus, will actually move from its current location on the chromosome and jump to a different spot on the chromosome. If this transposon jumps to a different part of the chromosome and happens to land in the middle of this gene C here, then it no longer functions and it can no longer produce the purple pigment. So having the transposon in here prevents the production of the normal pigment, and now this disrupted gene is inactive, and the kernel can only produce yellow pigments. So the transposon interferes every now and then with the production of the purple pigment. That's because it's jumped from its usual location into the middle of a perfectly good functioning gene and stopped it from working. This is how we realize that they exist. Now, it turns out that transposons are not just a curiosity that we might look at Halloween when we see our Indian corn, but they're really quite widespread. And in fact, their existence has been essential for the development of a very important forensic technique called DNA fingerprinting. 95% of the human genome doesn't code for proteins. 95% of our genome consists of what's believed to be just junk DNA, just stretches of gattaca, gattaca, gattaca that are not transcribed. There's no protein resulting from that stretch of the DNA. Where does this junk DNA come from? Well, a lot of it apparently has originated from these transposons that not merely move around, but also duplicate themselves and insert stretches of useless DNA in the midst of other parts of the chromosome. And so we've already seen these different features when we looked at transcription and then translation, that process had to find the exons, the coding part of the DNA that's going to end up as a protein, and get rid of these introns, which are just nonsense phrases. Okay? Well, these nonsense phrases, it seems, in many cases, have been put there by transposons in our history. Now, the coding DNA, these bits that do have a function and end up as proteins, those sequences are incredibly similar from one individual to the next. So 99% of a stretch of hemoglobin is the same in one individual to the next. But the way this junk gets passed around and inserted into different parts of the chromosome means that if you start looking in those regions, the sequence of Gattaca and those non-coding regions are really pretty random and were very much different from one individual to the next. And the development of the DNA fingerprints was because probes were developed that specifically target those junk DNA regions and splice the DNA or slice the DNA into different sized chunks, depending on the precise sequence. And no two individual humans are exactly the same, but it's because of that random nature, the way the transposons have put useless bits of DNA and interspersed them into our chromosomes. So, just now that you're familiar with the fact that there's so much of this out there, to the extent that we each have a unique DNA fingerprint, let's take into account the fact that transposons not merely move around within our own genomes, but they can spread from one individual to the next. Bacterial chromosome is that one long circular chromosome, and most of the genes in a coding bacteria are in that long circular chromosome. But as that slide showed earlier, there's also little circular links of DNA that also exist within the bacterial cell, and these are called plasmids. And these don't typically code for anything useful in terms of the proteins that make up the cell's wall or have anything to do with its metabolism. They just reside inside the bacterial cell. Now, these plasmids have a very peculiar characteristic. They are essentially like transposons, and they can insert themselves at any time into that long chromosome of the bacteria. So here's the plasmid inserting itself into the main chromosome. And it's now integrated. The plasmid is no longer a separate entity, but it's now just a short stretch within the overall long length of the chromosome. These plasmids not only can move themselves into the current chromosome, but they can also pass from one bacteria to another. So plasmids are almost can be viewed as an infectious agent that go from one bacteria to another. Now, we have these different kinds of disruptive forces, whether it's a plasmid in bacteria or it's the transposons in a diploid organism like Barbara McClintock saw affecting the pigmentation of the ear of corn. In Drosophila, there's a particular kind of transposal element or a transposon called a P element, and it's highly infectious and it spreads from one host to another in Drosophila or fruit flies. And I just want to take time now to remind us that wherever we find these kinds of genetic selfish elements, we also see counter strategies. We had the suppressor genes back with the mitotic drive in the Y-killing chromosome in the mosquito. Now in Drosophila, we have repressor genes that protect against these infectious transposons. So here we have a female who has not yet been infected with these transposable elements, but she also doesn't have any protection against them. If she mates with a male who has these infectious transposons, she will have offspring that look normal, but they've got the P element, they don't have a repressor, and they have an unstable germline. So let's contrast that female with another one who possesses a genetic resistance against these P elements. So here we have a female, she's not yet infected with the P elements, but she has a repressor gene that protects her offspring from these transposable elements. When she mates with an infected male, his transposons get into the offspring, and their offspring will now be fine. Without the repressor, the P elements are spreading so quickly within the genome of these offspring that they saturate the chromosomes. So the transposons are exploding within that genome. But with a repressor gene, this can't happen. And so gene function remains normal. It's not like you're having all of those pigment genes that we saw in the corn being turned off by transposons. These transposons are stopped in their tracks, and there's no further damage caused by them, thanks to the repressor gene. So these selfish genetic elements can move from one part of the genome to another in the same individual, like in the Indian corn. And they can even move from one individual to the next, like the plasmids in bacteria and the P elements in Drosophila.